Hello, and welcome to a status update for EDB missions currently underway. Following the mysterious disappearance of the Hyperion shuttle over the Atlantic Ocean during its re-entry test, investigations were conducted to assess whether other craft could suffer a similar fate. These investigations are indeterminate and are partially responsible for the long delay in EDB launches. That did not, however, affect missions currently underway, and here we see the Tarvos antimatter production ship. The Tarvos currently has Calden Kerman and Ludman Kerman on board, and of their consumables, they have 149 days remaining. Waste heat is well under control. Of its thorium fluoride fuel for the nuclear reactors, it has 868 units out of a possible 1,245 remaining, so plenty of time to refuel it. Of antimatter production, we see that it has 841 milligrams of antimatter. The total containment possible is 80 grams, so plenty of capacity for further antimatter production. The generator is operating at 51.9% efficiency, producing antimatter at 1.149% efficiency. Calden and Ludman will remain on board for at least 6 more months. Turning now to the Dion-1 interplanetary probe, the Dion-1 was one of the first missions for the EDB, and it has spent its time in low Earth orbit, making sure that its systems have checked out for a very long journey to Jupiter first. And it has finally lined up with Jupiter for its transfer. The phase angle with Jupiter is correct. It has 102,000 units of electric charge on board, 525,000 units of xenon. It has its third stage, which was part of its launch stack, and that third stage has 2,328 meters per second remaining, which would not be enough to get out of Earth's sphere of influence, much less boost it to its Jupiter transfer. However, it also has 23,000 meters per second in an ion stage. Here we see the Ullage rockets lighting up, settling the fuel for the J2, the J2 lighting, and so the J2 makes its initial burn to boost the orbit of the Dion-1. The resulting orbit after this burn is an apoapsis of 40,128 kilometers with a periapsis of 323 kilometers. The period of that orbit is nearly 12 hours. While the ion engine has 23,000 meters per second of delta V available to it, it does take an inordinate amount of time to burn that delta V, roughly 24 hours. And so obviously we will not bring you all the orbit boosting burns, and it will take multiple orbit boosting burns in order to get it to the proper escape velocity. And so you see here the J2 running out, and the Dion-1 reaches its apoapsis before letting go of the third stage. We get a scenic simulated view of the Dion-1 above the Earth as it prepares to dump its third stage. And here we are with third stage separation. And the third stage is safely away from the craft. And then the Dion-1 was tasked to reorient itself so that solar panels were facing the sun in optimal position. Remember, it's got massive batteries to power its ion burns, and it needs those replenished. The burns are going to be taking place on the dark side of the planet, unfortunately. However, if it tried to do a burn longer than its batteries had a capacity for, it would deviate too much from the intended maneuver node, and therefore not reached a desired orbit. So its batteries are correctly sized for the maneuvers that will boost its orbit. And so we see here the first ion engine burn. The burn boosted its orbit to apoapsis of 56,689 kilometers, a period of 18 hours around the Earth. Of its 525,000 units of xenon, it burned 5,000. Here we see its onboard camera taking a look at the probe, unfortunately, of course, in the dark. so not much to see of the planet Earth. After this initial ion burn, the Dion did a subsequent ion burn to boost its orbit to 91,512 kilometers, a period of 1 day, 9 hours, and it will continue to make these orbit boosting burns on its way to Jupiter. And so with that, we will leave the Dion 1 and hope to see it again as it departs the Earth for the final time and makes its way to the giant planet of the solar system. During its long trip, we will not be able to convey camera views because many of its systems will be shut down in order to provide thermal protection and minimize the wear and tear on its electronics. And so it's a long trip to Jupiter, and we will have to hope that the Dion 1 gets there safely through all the ravages of space. Next, we turn to Titan Station, which is currently playing host to Jeb, Bill, Bob, Shelby, and Guzman Kerman. Shelby and Guzman Kerman, of course, transferred to Titan Station on board the Hyperion shuttle after its swing by the moon. The Hyperion shuttle's reentry test was not a manned reentry test, obviously, because that would have been quite dangerous, and especially in the case with it disappearing as it did. However, Titan Station is in a little bit of a problem here, as it's no longer useful as an antimatter production facility and does not require its full crew. Jeb, Bill, and Bob decided to transfer to the Calliope and make their way back down to the surface. This was Jeb's idea, and part of the purpose was to demonstrate that it was safe to re-enter, that whatever happened to the Hyperion shuttle would not happen to Jeb, Bill, and Bob on the Calliope, and that would relieve some of the tension that is currently at Mission Control. Of course, while they were preparing for this, Mission Control tried to dissuade Jeb from the plan, but Jeb decided to go ahead with it. Shelby and Guzming will stay on the station, keep it warm. They have ample supplies. For just the two of them, they have 614 days worth of supplies. And so they will continue conducting scientific experiments while Jeb, Bill, and Bob return to the surface in the hopes of doing something. In hopes of doing something much more useful. And we will now track their progress towards the surface aboard the Calliope crew transfer vehicle. The Calliope undocked and used RCS to back away from the station. The Calliope was launched on June 26th of this year, so Jeb, Bill, and Bob have been aboard Titan Station for more than 5 months now. They were scheduled to be on board for 6 months, however, Jeb felt that it was necessary to return to the surface to help the EDB through these tough times, and so that's why they are coming down here. And you can see the careful undocking of the Calliope away from Titan Station, making sure that the maneuvers did not in any way jeopardize any part of the station. You can see the station from the cockpit view here. The external views were provided by camera drones around the station, which constantly provide external views of Titan Station. You can see docking away further as the Calliope made sure to reach the safety range away from the station before starting its deorbit burn. Here you see the Calliope tilted a bit in order to give the occupants a good view of the station. They wanted to get a last glimpse of the station's magnificence as they cleared out of the area. And then here we see RCS being employed to flip the craft around in order to line it up with its retrograde vector. RCS being a little bit noisy here. Eventually, the Calliope was turned around in a safe distance away from the station and ready for its deorbit burn. The deorbit burn would take it to roughly 63 kilometers periapsis. and that is deemed in the safe zone for re-entry. The Calliope carries with it 8 days worth of supplies for the Kerbals, just in case something were to happen. Here you see the deorbit burn using the service module engine. The atmosphere within the cockpit was placid, perhaps a little bit grim, as the Kerbonauts realized that they were returning home after a long stint in space, and a somewhat glorious stint in space as they watched the station come together. But they are returning home with the EDB in a somewhat more confused state than when they first left the surface of the Earth. Of course, nothing cheers an astronaut up more than the spectacular sights of the planet from space, and indeed that was the case here as well, as you'll see here, the Kerbonauts flipping their craft around, giving it a little bit of a roll in order to get the best possible view. And you can see there. Quite enthusiastic about the kinds of sights the Earth has to offer. Even after 5 months in orbit, they never tire of it. It never gets old. Here over West Africa, they're getting ready to release the service module. And off it goes, service module released over West Africa. The target for landing was the Indian Ocean. Their goal was to land in the Indian Ocean off the coast of Western Australia. And we will soon see whether they actually made that target. Jeb eventually gets the craft oriented to take advantage of its lifting body characteristics. However, I think at this point, he was still interested in a bit of sightseeing, and so not entirely sure he's got it oriented properly just yet. Still getting a good look outside of the windows of the Calliope. As it eventually turned out, they made more use of the lifting body characteristics than they probably should have. And here we see them actually arriving at the coast of Australia, overshooting their target because the craft was simply getting too much lift, much more than was anticipated. At this point, it was pretty clear that a touchdown over land was anticipated. Not a problem for the capsule, but still a bit of an inconvenience for the rescue crew, which will take an extra amount of time to get to the Kerbonauts. Re-entry heating was per spec. In fact, the extra lift provided by the capsule ensured that G-forces were kept under wraps. Here we see the most extreme point in the re-entry. This is a simulated view, of course. The in-cockpit views are the actual views, and we can see the particulars of their re-entry profile there. Not very easy to lift the nose up at this phase of re-entry, but still a bit deflected away from the retrograde vector. G-forces, as you can see there, quite moderate. The re-entry made for quite a sight over the Western Australian skies for those who were up watching and waiting for news of the return of the Calliope, and here you see a nice shot. Once the re-entry heating dissipated and the G-forces diminished, the crew was more relaxed, though still a little bit concerned about the rescue situation, and somewhat unsure whether they would be returning on land or on water. This is heat shield release and initial parachute deployment. Initial drogue chute deployment was good, and the crew waited patiently to find out whether their parachutes would deploy as expected. And so, a long ride down from 6 kilometers in altitude, and indeed, the main parachutes deployed with their spectacular array in the night sky over Australia. The crew soon got their answer as to whether they were over land or water, and in fact it was over land, now over northern Australia, and we'll soon show you a map of where they ended up. But at this point the crew was confident of their safe return. However, they did wonder how much of their supplies they would have to go through before being rescued. And there we have final touchdown as the parachutes were cut and the crew is safely on the ground. Word from Mission Control was that they would have to wait until morning for the rescue parties to reach them. And here we see the location of their touchdown in northern Australia. Surprisingly, the next morning, press crews actually arrived before the rescue crews, and so the Kerbonauts emerged from their capsule to give a little photo op while the rescue crews were still making their way to them. The press got to get a good look at the Kerbals and took this great shot of them looking at the sunrise next to their capsule waiting for the rescue crews to arrive. And so there you have it, the return of the Calliope successfully. Perhaps this and the return of Jeb, Bill, and Bob will give the EDB more confidence to proceed with their more ambitious plans, and we will find out more about that in the coming weeks. Thank you for watching, and we hope you enjoyed this status update from the EDB.